So good afternoon, everybody. Thank you very much for coming along. Today, as has just been explained, I'm going to be talking about psychiatry in the Second World War. More specifically, I'll be talking about the work of British military psychiatrists in the Second World War, and I'll be focusing mainly on the British Army. And I'll be looking at the range of activity in which they were involved. That's everything from personnel selection to the actual treatment of casualties. And I'll try to give you some sense of where progress was made during the war. And I'll argue, I'm afraid, that not a great deal of progress was actually made. Although there was, as I'll explain too, there was considerable innovation. Now, I've got 45 minutes or so, and it'll just be broad brushstrokes, really. I'll talk first about the state of British military psychiatry in 1939, 1940, the outbreak of the war, and when it was first put to the test. Then I'll move on and I'll look a little bit at selection and screening, and I'll talk about that and the contribution made by British psychiatrists to selection and screening of candidates for military service. And then I'll look, finally, I'll wind up by talking about the treatment of psychiatric casualties, who during the war was pretty much the primary cause of medical casualty and comprised between 30 and 40% of those who were diagnosed with disease and were discharged from the army as a consequence. Now, this topic is actually quite under-researched, as you'll all be aware of shellshock as a concept. The First World War has been very much a focus of research for some time. The Second World War has been somewhat different. There have been some outstanding studies of it, particularly the work of Ben Shepherd, who's wrote a book called A War of Nerves, with which some of you may be familiar. Edgar Jones at King's, professor of psychiatry at King's, has done some really excellent work as well. And I'll be drawing on their work as I go along. And also the work of Nafsika Thalassis, who was a doctoral student, wrote a PhD on military psychiatry, British military psychiatry in the Second World War too. But the statements I'll be making here are all my own, the opinions are my own as well. And I'll also, you'll have to forgive me, I'll indulge my own research as well, indulge myself here, and I will actually talk a little bit about my research at Oxford as an example of how psychiatry worked on a particular unit and the way that British military psychiatrists and psychologists were employed in a particularly elite British unit. What I'm going to do, however, is I'll begin with this story, if this works. Yes. Right. This story appeared in an Australian newspaper in September 1940, and it was based on an article in The Lancet that had just been published. Now, I have the transcript here, and I'll read it out. And you can read it too. So actually, this is quite interactive. You will also have been doing some reading yourselves here. And I'll read you through this. So Dunkirk soldiers cured by hypnotism. London, July the 30th. Soldiers back from Dunkirk have been cured of nervous disorders by means of hypnotism. Remarkable results were reported this week by Dr. William Sargent, well-known London psychiatric specialist. One patient puzzled the doctor. With infinite care, he took the man back to the frightfulness of the hours on the French beach. Still, there was no clue that might provide a basis on which to formulate a cure. Then hypnotic treatment was tried. Under hypnosis, the soldier, a nervous wreck, gave Dr. Sargent a clear picture of his ordeal on the beach beside his soldier brother. The brother was mortally wounded. The soldier, heartbroken at the agony of his brother, shot him to hasten his death. Tortured mind, subtitle. Back home, subconsciously, he was torturing his mind about what he had done that he could not remember except under hypnosis. Knowing all, the doctor was able to reassure the stricken man, who was quickly restored to health. Now, the article goes on to describe a similar treatment that Sargent delivered to a Royal Navy sailor who'd experienced losing a friend and considered himself at fault for losing his friend's death as well. And then the article continues. Behind these stories of successful treatment lies a scheme which the British War Office has instituted to mobilise psychological experts throughout the country for this work. Shellshock exacted a heavy toll in the last war. Today, the most advanced treatment, including hypnotism, suggestion, and other forms of psychotherapy are used. They are also interested in prevention as well as cure. Every recruit undergoes a minor form of psychoanalysis at his medical examination to discover if he has any history or symptom of nervous disorder which might affect his discipline in the front line. Thus, men who might crack up under strain, or, as in the last war, might run the risk of being shot for cowardice, in reality, due to some neurosis, will be found in time. And the impression of this article very much, I think, gives a positive image of the state of British military psychiatry in 1940. There's talk of remarkable results, successful treatment. Sergeant has restored that soldier's health after one of the most possibly worst imaginable tragic and traumatic experiences. The article talks about experts being mobilised by the War Office, today's Ministry of Defence, really the equivalent, to deliver advanced treatment. This is hypnotism, suggestion, psychotherapy. There's also talk of prevention as well as cure. And this hints at the screening that's in place to weed out vulnerable characters, vulnerable personalities who might break down in combat. There's also reference to men being shot in the First World War due to some neurosis, and this, of course, implies that there is understanding now in 1940 that men do break down because of strain and that it is wrong to shoot them. Something not mentioned in the newspaper piece is that Sargent had also used drugs as part of his treatment. And since the 1930s, increasing use had been made of drugs by British psychiatrists to assist with sedation and abreaction techniques, abreaction being the reliving of an experience in order to purge it, really, of its emotional excesses. Now, in the soldier's case, Sargent had administered an injection of sodium amytal as a sedative and to assist with his hypnosis. Now, on the strength of this sort of upbeat newspaper article, you might expect that British military psychiatrists were well prepared for the war, and the British military was well prepared, and that subsequently they may have had great success in dealing with psychiatric casualties during the Second World War. This is also the impression that you sometimes get from reading official histories of the Second World War, official histories of the medical contribution that was made by the British Army. But the reality, as I'll discuss now, was somewhat different. Certainly, there were some interesting innovations were made, and I'll discuss some of those, and certainly some good work was done. But in many respects, the degree of success was far more modest than you might expect by reading an article such as this. Now, 1939, Britain was certainly better prepared than it was in 1914. In 1914, the British military had been totally unprepared for the tidal wave of psychiatric casualties that came back from the front line in France and Belgium. One estimate is that the British suffered 200,000 casualties, psychiatric casualties, during the First World War. Now, as well as being unprepared, there was also great confusion as to what the causes were of all of this, which was not helped at all by the vast range of symptoms that traumatised soldiers were exhibiting. And these ranged from paralysis to being struck dumb, to no hearing, to muscle spasms, to nightmares, being unable to speak, and of course exhaustion and tiredness and great fatigue. Now, the very first interpretations seemed to be mainly viewing shell shock, as it was termed, with an organic explanation. And the idea here was that there was concussive or toxic impact of a shell explosion, and that this shell shock, as it was called by the soldiers, was always confined to soldiers who'd been in close proximity to the exploding shell. This is Charles Myers on the left, and this is an article he wrote in 1915. On the right, it appeared in The Lancet, and this is really the first appearance in print of the word shell shock. Now, in time, it became clear that this interpretation was not satisfactory. Symptoms of shell shock, first of all, were being displayed by soldiers who'd been nowhere near a shell explosion. Many physicians in time began to see the symptoms were functional and related to the stress of combat, which was both real stress and imagined as well. And some believe that from analysing the sufferers as well, that vulnerability to physical, to psychiatric difficulties could be exacerbated by poor upbringing, by previous psychiatric disorders before individuals had joined the army, and by poor health, and by fatigue. And eventually some even also became to believe that all soldiers really were vulnerable, and that breakdown would occur to anyone given the worst possible circumstances. And Myers himself actually came to see the word shell shock as outdated. Although he was responsible for it first appearing in print, he very soon decided that it recommended that it should be struck out of official wording of incidences such as this. And later the army also followed suit and declared that it should be struck out of all formal diagnosis. Now, despite this, of course, shell shock has become very much associated with the popular image of the First World War, conceptions of wartime casualties, and remains in common use as a catch-all term really to describe all First World War mental, psychiatric casualties and distress. And it's even described today as a forerunner, if you like, of post-traumatic stress disorder, even though the diagnosis or the description of PTSD in the DSM is very, very different these days to how shell shock was interpreted and related to conditions of the First World War. Our responses to this epidemic, really, of casualties were many and various. As the war developed, emphasis became to be placed on treating psychiatric casualties as close to the front line as possible. Now, this was for various reasons, to stop people becoming accustomed to how they felt and to stop the condition becoming more ingrained, the suffering becoming more ingrained on their minds. It was also to stop them from becoming too comfortable as well with their condition and to prevent malingering. The further the people came away from the front line, the more reluctant they were to go back. But the overall aim really was to increase the chances of getting them back to the front line. And one of the early proponents of this forward psychiatry was Charles Myers again. He was drawing on what the French were actually doing at the time. Myers was also a medical officer who recommended therapeutic treatments. So he was very much in favour of hypnosis, an atmosphere of calm, talking to the individual, going through his experiences and trying to aim for a cathartic effect by discussing and raising awareness in the individual of what had actually caused him to break down. Another proponent of that kind of therapeutic treatment was Captain William Rivers, who was working at Craig Lockhart Hospital. And many of you will be familiar with his work with Siegfried Sassoon, which was immortalised in a book by Pat Barker and a film in the 1990s. Yeah, there are other doctors who felt a more physical response was effective with certain symptoms. And one of these was a chap called Lewis Yeland. Yeland was a neurologist based mainly in London who favoured the use of electricity. And this he applied with electrodes to various parts of the body. So, for example, if a man was struck dumb, he might apply the electrodes to the throat, hoping to stimulate the voice box. If he was paralysed in a limb, then the electrodes would be applied to the muscles of the arm or the leg. Now, his methods may seem brutal, but they're undoubtedly successful in some cases, particularly with physical paralysis and also loss of speech. But, of course, they never really engage with the underlying cause of mental distress and didn't aim for soothing the mental stress that a sufferer was also affected by. Now, despite all this practice and all these measures that were in place in the First World War, these different types of thinking and different types of approach, and despite also a great deal of wartime medical research, it's a mistake to assume that the lessons and the experience of the First World War left the British and the British Army in particular well prepared for the coming conflict in 1939 and future waves of psychiatric casualties. Between the wars, in fact, 1919 to 1939, it's fair to say that British military psychiatry more or less stagnated. By 1939, there were only six British doctors in the British military, so these are army doctors in the British military, who had really any kind of psychiatric training at all. Now, after the war broke out, this situation did improve. In 1942, for example, a dedicated directorate of psychiatry was set up in the War Office, And by 1944, as opposed to six psychiatrists at the beginning, there were over 200 working for the British Army, about half of which were attached to British units overseas. But in 1940, when the British Expeditionary Force went to France, it had just a couple of psychiatrists attached to it, and there was no system of providing forward advanced psychiatry. That was the system that had been found to be effective in some ways in the First World War. Nor was there any tier system in place, and this was a process where you had the forward psychiatry, first of all, and then casualties, if it was felt they needed further treatment, would be sent back to a hospital slightly further away from the front, and if it was felt that they required further treatment still, then they'd be evacuated even further behind and perhaps to the UK. In 1940 in France, however, psychiatric casualties were evacuated straight to Britain, although to be fair, in June 1940, the campaign was moving so swiftly that in many cases there was no real alternative. But this flood of casualties straight back to Britain explains why in Sutton Emergency Hospital in Surrey, where William Sargent was working, that's why he was confronted with Dunkirk survivors in the summer of 1940. Right, I'll talk to you about screening and selection now. And in the late 1930s, instead of packing the army with psychiatrists, the British Army felt that it wanted to apply itself more to selection and screening. Now, the RAF, the Royal Air Force, and the Royal Navy, their procedures were a little bit more sophisticated for recruitment. At that stage, they did include, for example, an interview, a sit-down interview, in the very first stage of joining the Navy or the RAF. The British Army, however, beyond a medical, there was no other real system of assessment. So it was with the intention of improving this situation that when war broke out, the British Army mobilised and recruited various British psychiatrists and put them to work devising and developing a series of tests for recruits into the army. And the point of all this was to increase efficiency, to improve the quality of the army too, that's to put the right man in the right job, and also to reduce wastage. The army senior officers had an eye on the fallout of the First World War, and they wanted to minimise that happening again. There was also a common belief by the late 1930s that certain individuals were mentally deficient in a way and were more likely to suffer from psychiatric problems in a wartime environment. Now, several tests for the other ranks, first of all, as opposed to the officers, were devised, and these included a verbal intelligence test, a mathematical test, reasoning tests, and an interview with a psychiatrist, again, a sit-down interview with a psychiatrist, which was new. And this was to explore the man's background, and the psychiatrist would ask him about his interests and try to explore his mental stability, his past mental health. Also at this stage, they would look into the man's employment record, his education as well, and also his previous work experience before joining the army, what he'd done for a living, again, to try to assess what he was like and his perhaps vulnerability to future stress. Now, was this successful? It seems to have had limited efficiency, really. The intelligence testing was undoubtedly the most useful and efficient tool because it was at least based on evidence. The other tests were mostly predictive, and the conclusions were based on guesswork, really, of the conditions that a particular individual would find once he'd joined the army. Now, tests for officers were more in-depth, and these were known as the War Office Selection Boards, and these were introduced in 1942. These required prospective army officers to attend a three-day assessment course where they underwent a series of tests. Now, some of these tests were designed to assess physical stamina, physical fitness. Others, though, sought to assess character, initiative, and resourcefulness. Again, there was an interview with a psychiatrist, and this was to assess mental stability, as it was, again, for the other ranks as well. There were also tests to assess intelligence, again, as for the other ranks. And there were new tests, too, that were psychological and physical, to get a more rounded picture of the individual being tested. For example, there was a group discussion to test verbal and social skills, so the candidates would be grouped together and sat in a room and given a topic to discuss. There was a word association test, which was originally devised by Jung. There were outdoor group tasks. Now, these were designed to see who would emerge as a natural leader. They were leaderless tasks, so the group together was put to work over a particular test, for example, to manhandle a log over a wall or over a fictional minefield. And the instructors and the psychiatrists would watch to see who would emerge from the group as the natural leader, who would perhaps shy back from commitment, who was a follower, who was a kind of reluctant follower. And there are also more focused tests of leadership where, again, a group would be put together and given an outdoor task, but then one of them would be put in charge, and his job, of course, would be to manage the others and see them try to accomplish the task at hand. Now, again, was this successful? And again, it's hard to assess. The later training reports appear to stress that the assessment was useful and beneficial, but again, it's mainly because of the intelligence testing, and it did help to gear people towards selecting soldiers for particular jobs. The biggest flaw, again, was that all the tests were predictive. It was especially problematic when considering a man's susceptibility to breakdown in the future, because, of course, the key variables that actually have a role in breakdown, these are morale, the intensity of a battle, the preparedness of an individual for a battle, these things can't be tested or really predicted when a man is just being inducted into the army at the beginning. There are also other little flaws as well that it's important to acknowledge, and these are cultural flaws and cultural opinions of particular individuals who go through these assessment processes. And this can be quite interested quite neatly by a letter to the Times in January 1941. Now, the author of this letter was a colonel who worked at an officer training unit. This was the unit to which officers were then sent after completing the War Office Selection Board. Now, this colonel's rather novel argument was that only the upper classes had the right skills to be army officers, because they'd grown up with servants and therefore they knew how to handle the responsibility of dealing with people. He also felt that his argument went on, and he felt that everyone else pretty much had been reared in an atmosphere where the state spoon feeds everyone from the cradle to the grave and no one feels any responsibility for his fellow man. Now that letter actually got the colonel sacked, perhaps unsurprisingly, and it is an extreme viewpoint. Nevertheless, there's still plenty of people who felt that education, good education, experience of being an employer, all of these actually mattered. Now, of course, these tests have also had some sort of an enduring legacy. Those of you perhaps who've had experience of a commissioning board for the British Army will recognise things such as the group discussion, the leaderless tasks, the command tasks, the verbal assessment tasks, and also the interview, which are still in place and still used to assess officer candidates for the British Army. Now, military psychiatrists are also employed in selecting screening for other military work, and it's at this point that I'm going to indulge you with my own, or myself really, by sharing with you my own recent research that I'm doing at Oxford at the moment, which is on the contribution made by professional psychiatrists and psychologists to the selection of personnel for British Special Forces, and in particular, an organisation called the Special Operations Executive, which was known by the acronym SOE, which is how I refer to it. Now, SOE is small, and this is just a small example, a small little study that I'll give you here. So 100,000 individuals went through the War Office Selection Boards for officer training. Around about 2,000 went through SOE's particular form of selection. But it does give some impression, I think, of the levels of sophistication that were reached in the British Army or the British military environment and in the world that was the world of selection training during the war. So I think it does have some value here to be looked at, for being looked at. So SOE was a secret British organisation, as some of you may know, that was set up in 1940 to encourage resistance and carry out sabotage in enemy-occupied territory. And it did this by sending agents into enemy territory to work with local resistance groups and to carry out individual tasks. This rather unique line of work was high strain, it was very solitary, it was very dangerous. This was behind the lines work, remember. So this was people working alone, right under the noses of the enemy. And men and women were required who had particular qualities and particular abilities. It took a while, but after a time, SOE began to get some idea of what these qualities might be. And I'm going to read out an account here by the head of SOE's Norwegian section, SOE was split into country sections devoted to dealing with different countries. And this is an Englishman called John Skinner Wilson, Scotsman actually, I should stress that. And he's writing about the agency sent into Norway. At first, men of the commando type were recruited. But however brave and efficient these men were, it began to be realised that other abilities and qualities were required. The tough gangster of detective fiction was of little use, and in fact likely to be a danger. Help and support to Norwegian resistance could only be provided by men of character who were prepared to adapt themselves and their views, even their orders at times, to other people and other considerations once they saw that change was necessary. Common sense and adaptability are the two main virtues required in anyone who is to work underground, assuming a deep and broad sense of loyalty, which is the basic essential. Without some stability of character, no man could work with any chance of success and for any length of time in the most difficult and dangerous tasks. Now, you might think that an organisation like SOE, which is engaged in such specialist modern warfare, would have had recourse to talented specialist professionals to help it with its recruitment and selection processes. In fact, until 1943, its recruitment processes were very ad hoc, very amateur, dangerously so, in fact. It hadn't been uncommon, for example, for an existing member of SOE to recruit somebody over a drink. Now, according to Cabinet Office records, they've been classified for pretty much over half a century, the decision to introduce an improved selection was precipitated by a concern that too many agents or candidates for working as agents were failing during the training stage. So that's between recruitment and going into the field. But SOE's own records, which have been released over the last 15 years or so, and are still being released in stages, do suggest that in fact there was a worse situation than that, and people were breaking down actually on operations, which of course was a very different kettle of fish. Looking through the files, there are plenty of examples of agents who were considered in the light of how they acted to have broken down as psychiatric casualties. Just to give you a couple of examples, in 1943, one agent, a Frenchman, parachuted into France and broke down immediately and went to live with his wife within days, weeks of arriving and did no work whatsoever. In his case, he was betrayed, did no good, he was betrayed and arrested and was later executed in a concentration camp, which gives you some idea of the threat that agents were under, and they all knew that was a fate that they risked by going into enemy territory in the first place. Another example, a Danish agent who parachuted into Denmark was assessed to have reacted so badly that two fellow agents radioed London for permission to execute him, since he'd contacted the enemy and was acting in a very, it was a threat to their own safety. And in fact, permission was granted and he was indeed killed and his body was dumped in a lake. A similar case occurred in Belgium where an English agent was dropped in. And again, very similar to the first one, panicked, went to a hotel where his sister was working. But his colleagues, again, his SOE colleagues, were so concerned in Belgium that they actually shot him and pushed his body down a well. Now, for a long time, SOE had no alternative, really, but to recruit in this ad hoc way. They had very limited resources, there was a concern for security as well, and they were ignorant really of alternative methods. And eventually a fresh system was introduced in 1943, and this was called the Student Assessment Board. It was based quite closely on the War Office selection boards, which I've just described. Again, there were a three-day test, employed psychologists, psychiatrists who were present during the testing. It repeated also a few of the War Office selection board tests as well. So these were reasoning tests, an interview, group discussion, outdoor group tasks. SOE also developed his own tests with the employment of the psychiatrists. For example, group tests to assess frustration and a student's reaction to frustration and failure. The testing staff would sometimes insert in a group someone who's been deliberately tasked to be as obstructive and as obnoxious as possible. And then the psychiatrists would watch to see how somebody dealt with that. A variation on that was called a construction test, where a candidate was taken alone and given a cube or in parts or some sort of model to construct, but he was also given two assistants to help him. Now, what he didn't know was that these two assistants had been tasked to be as unhelpful as possible. And then, of course, the psychiatrist watched that and just see how he reacted. Now, once again, this was very much a preliminary selection process, like the War Office selection boards. But nevertheless, SOE seems to have been pleased with it. It compared very well with the system beforehand. At least that's what it felt. But again, there was still a very heavy predictive element to it. And it was still largely guesswork about what conditions agents would face in the field, what could possibly cause them to break down. And again, it was very much based on their assessment at the time of a candidate's psychiatric makeup. A few agents did return, and they did feed in knowledge of the field, conditions in the field, to try to improve the recruitment process, but there was still a lot of feeling their way forward in the dark, really. Rather like the War Office selection boards of the British Army, though, there is another, quite a long-term legacy of SOE's recruitment process. 1942-1943, the American OSS, some of you may have heard of, which was almost an American equivalent, very broadly, of what SOE was, came over and it looked at the War Office selection boards and it looked at what SOE was doing and came up with its own system, which had developed in the US. And that today, if you read histories of assessment centres, generally the historians of the modern-day assessment centre tend to look at the American, the OSS form, the schools that they developed, which is very closely based on the British model. They tend to see those as the grandfather of today's assessment centres. So many of the tests are the same, the concept of group discussions and these sorts of things. But in fact, the heritage of the assessment centre does go back beyond the American system. It does come back to the British system, comes back to the SOE system, the War Office selection boards. And also, actually, if you take it all the way back, it does go back to German systems as well from the 1920s and 30s, who were also trying to explore individuals and get an all-round image of what they were like. In fact, this photograph on the right, I was in Washington last week, and this photograph on the right, which again, some of you, any of you with British military background will identify that as a group task outside. These individuals are trying to take various planks over a wall and across what seems to be just a sandy area, but they're obviously under permission, under instructions not to tread on it. This actually comes from American records. It's a 70-year-old photograph, and this is very closely modelled on what the British were doing. And this is another one. This is the Rorschach test. This, again, comes from an American secret OSS file showing how individuals were tested by their reaction to the Rorschach test, which is the ink blot test, which some of you may be familiar, to sort of assess abstract reasoning. Now, a final thing I'll say about the employment of psychiatrists in selecting military recruits is that their advice wasn't always taken. In 1943, the War Office decided that psychiatrists should be removed from the work of the War Office selection boards. There was a feeling that they weren't particularly needed, they weren't particularly helpful. And I think this reflected, I think fair to say, there was a certain wariness at the time of the contribution that psychiatrists could actually make, and doubts about their value and the value of their opinions and contribution. Now, existence of this second guessing really also comes through from the work that I've been doing on British Special Forces, and I'll just briefly give you an example of that. I'll read you through this. Don't be too horrified, I will read it out. Now, this comes from an SOE file, an assessment of a Belgian candidate for operations for clandestine work inside Belgium. This is by Britain, by SOE's in-house psychiatrist. And it's quite unusual to find case studies like this. These are case notes, really. It's quite unusual to find these in any existing today in any sort of form, not just with SOE, but even with the military at all, because for various reasons, medical notes tend to be either still classified for data protection reasons, or they've been destroyed, which unfortunately is the case for most. I'll take you through this, and as you'll be able to tell, it's quite a negative report. Examination. A tall, fair Belgian with little personality and few leadership qualities. He is a cautious, depressive type with little internal mental stamina, and has little ability to stand on his own feet. He may, therefore, at times, appear moody and temperamental. He is very dependent on others. He lacks initiative. He's not likely to inspire confidence in others. Though he's not lacking in guts, there is little of the fighter in him, and he has little capacity for an aggressive attitude. He is generally apprehensive, fearing the worst, and is rather lacking in self-confidence. On the whole, he is ineffectual. And he has not been a great success in life. His life history bears this out. There's also a marked streak of nervous instability. He lives on his nerves, and though this may help in the short term, I do not feel he's likely to last any great length of time. That means that he's looking forward, what he means by that is length of time in the field as a clandestine agent. Then he goes on to talk about childhood, his emotional makeup again. And at the bottom, recommendation, I do not recommend that he should be used in the field. Now later on in this file, it's recorded this agent in particular was actually sent on operations into Belgium. And a little bit later in the file is this. So arrested on the 14th of September 1943 whilst returning from inspecting a landing ground. When interrogated, he stated that he was a deserter returning from Portugal. He was sentenced to 3 months imprisonment because his papers were not in order. He was imprisoned, sent to France, escaped by train, went home. Trial but failed to contact London. In July 1944, he came across a German patrol and, convinced they were after him, took to his heels and was shot. Now, there's no way of knowing whether this particular candidate's, this particular agent's mental psychiatric makeup had any contribution to his arrest and his ultimate fate. What is clear, however, of course, is that the warnings of the psychiatrists were not taken into account. And this was for reasons of manpower. SOE's Belgian section, their country section, had nobody else. They needed a man for a particular job. They took him and they sent him. Now this perceived, or a perceived, need for manpower, this is the need to make men available for operations of a warlike character, also characterises and shapes the work of those military psychiatrists who were involved in the treatment of casualties, and it's that that I'll talk about now. Now, the first major employment of casualties, of psychiatrists, among psychiatric casualties occurs not really in France in 1940, but in North Africa and in the Western Desert. Now, for 3 years from 1940 until spring of 1943, the Western Desert, North Africa, and for a little short time, East Africa too, these are the principal theatres in which the British Army was involved in the Western Hemisphere. It's also in North Africa, in this theatre, that the British begin to rediscover the concept I referred to earlier of administering treatment to casualties, psychiatric casualties, as close to the front line as possible, and then evacuating them back by stages according to the severity of their condition and their ability to respond to treatment. Now, the Australians seem to have tried to do this first. This was at Tobruk in 1941. Although, to be fair, at Tobruk in 1941, many are familiar with that. Tobruk was under siege, and they didn't really have much alternative again but to pursue immediate treatment of casualties pretty much right by the front line. Now, the idea of this tier system takes some time to become standardised, and it's only really after the El Alamein, this is October 42, November 42, that dedicated advanced forward psychiatric units come to be established to deliver quick, immediate support to British units advancing through the desert. Now, the underlying principles of this came to be known as the acronym of PI. P stood for proximity to the battle. The I stood for immediacy of action, the immediacy of treatment. And E was the expectancy of recovery. Now, this PI model was then repeated in Italy and later in Northwest Europe. Now later, if you read the accounts, official accounts of the war, and also the official reports at the time, contemporary reports, there is considerable exaggeration, perhaps, of the success of these sorts of treatments and procedures that were in place. For example, late July 1944, official claims would be made that 65% of psychiatric casualties in Normandy in the first 6 weeks of the fighting had been returned to normal duty. This is combatant duty. But in fact, the real figure on close analysis is closer to 10%. And in fact, in every theatre and every throughout the war, the return to duty and combat duty, frontline duty, was very low. It began to be sensed too that psychiatric casualties increased when the war was going badly. The army was in retreat. Also, that again, this idea that men with low intelligence and with neurotic, psychotic backgrounds are more vulnerable, more likely to break down. There was a belief, again, that greater strength should be put to screening and selection to stop unsuitable men, if you like, reaching the front lines. It was also appreciated that a man's sense of responsibility, his sense of duty, should be stressed. So a man suffering from psychiatric trouble should be stressed to him that his duty was to his friends and his unit, and that this could make a difference to his mental resilience. Also began to be seen that men with excellent fighting records could break down. Again, this was the idea that every man had a breaking point, and again, this was something that had been seen in the First World War. It was also becoming clear that the only effective way of reducing battle exhaustion, really, as it was becoming called, was to lower the intensity and the frequency of combat. Now, the treatment, too, varied, and it often took the form simply of delivering a sedative, just to calm agitation, better food and perhaps insulin and glucose to help gain weight. There was also some occupational therapy and some physical teamwork to boost confidence and instill a sense of duty and community. Pressure of work, however, frequently meant that ab reaction, perhaps assisted by hypnosis, was just not possible. It was just too time-consuming and impractical. And then there were some psychiatrists who didn't really see psychotherapy as useful at all. William Sargent, for example, if you remember, he's Dr. William Sargent, he's referred to in the newspaper article I showed you at the beginning. Sargent felt that sedation was important for stopping trauma becoming ingrained in an individual's personality. If severe anxiety continued, then he would perhaps also induce a coma that could last for several days to destroy what he felt were conditioned fears. Now, William Sargent really had a very low opinion of psychotherapy, which he called talk, talk, talk. And that's how he referred to it, and it doesn't feature at all in the work that he was doing. Now, in fact, though, the work of individual psychiatrists like Sargent did vary considerably. And what's striking from their accounts is the absence, really, of any systematic uniform form of treatment. Certainly their overall purpose in every case was to treat individuals with a view to returning them to the combat duty. That's the ideal. It's certainly what the army wanted. But there was a great variety in approach, a great variety in opinion as to what caused soldiers to break down, how to treat them, and what could be done to actually get them back into the battle. And to illustrate this, I'm going to talk about three contrasting examples. And the first is the work of Lieutenant Colonel Harold Palmer. Palmer was an army psychiatrist who was working in Tripoli in 1943. He was considered extremely able at what he was doing, and certainly his work on the face of it seems to be extremely effective. For the army, the ultimate gauge of success was the amount of soldiers who could be treated successfully and actually returned to the fighting line, fighting duty. And Palmer actually claimed an extremely high return to unit rate. He claimed that just 2% of his casualties were evacuated to the next line, 98% returned to full duty, and 30% of those actually returned to full battle duty. That might not seem so high, but at the time that was an extremely high proportion. Also, his results were achieved in very intense conditions, and his level of success should be qualified, though, by a few observations. He was actually working about 1,000 miles away from the next tier in the line, so he was under great pressure to keep psychiatric casualties to him and within him and not depend on the hospital facilities and the hospital ships to get people back to Alexandria further away in Egypt, because these were expensive and were required for more serious physical injuries. Palmer was totally focused on persuading the sick to return to action, to return to military duty. This was central to his form of treatment. He also considered most of them to be actually curable. He was also open to new ideas, new practices, and new treatments. His principal approach was to remind patients of their military duty and their responsibility. And his techniques ranged from therapy with the use of ether, which was really to relax the patient so that he could bring back memories and encourage a degree of catharsis, to more persuasive methods. And this is Palmer describing some of his methods. Every form of psychotherapy was used: persuasion, suggestion, re-education, analysis. On occasion, a man might be dressed down in public. At the same time, another man would be singled out for praise and encouragement. Only the psychiatrist was permitted to use the more aggressive forms of persuasion. But in certain cases, it undoubtedly had the desired effect. Now, the next example is Colonel Dugmore Hunter. Hunter was senior psychiatrist to 8th Army when it moved from North Africa into Italy. It was 1943-1944. Now, Hunter's results in treatment were also quite good, comparable to Palmer's. 30% of his patients, he claimed, returned to combat duty, and just 1% had to be evacuated all the way back to the UK. Unlike Palmer, however, Hunter's focus was not on treatment and certainly not on therapeutic treatment. Instead, he was very much focused on selecting those who should be withdrawn from the fighting line to prevent them from becoming casualties, psychiatric casualties. So his emphasis was on selection and prevention, but much closer to the front. Now, he classified soldiers into various types. These are sufferers, patients into various types. So these were soldiers who'd broken down due to a traumatic experience, or perhaps a series of traumatic experiences. Then there were soldiers who were exhausted. But there were also soldiers who Hunter felt, this was his opinion, who were just not capable of coping because their personality was weak and their background was inadequate. And what Hunter wanted to do was to treat curable men. That was his great emphasis on treatment. He felt that if they could be evacuated quickly, if they could be evacuated fast and treated, then they were much more likely to return to action eventually. And this is Hunter explaining his stance. In psychiatry, almost everything depends on the basic personality of the patient. Thus, one can afford to evacuate a good man early, knowing that he'll return to the unit with high morale, having clearly benefited from rest and treatment. The poorest human material is like a cheap car which must be run to the limit and then discarded. The psychiatrist cannot make good fighting men out of inadequate individuals. These should be sent back, he means evacuated to the next stage and eventually perhaps the UK if they had to be, only when they become a positive embarrassment. Now, Hunter's immediate treatment for those he considered inadequate or embarrassing or incurable was somewhat different to the techniques employed by Palmer. This is him again just explaining some of his techniques. Hysterical screaming and jabbering can often be stopped at once by means of a sharp command, a gallon or two of cold water, or the abrupt application to the face of the flat of the hand to the side of the face. These are to be regarded as common sense forms of first aid. There is no treatment for poor moral fibre beyond such rough and ready measures as can be administered on the spot. Detention is accepted as a rest cure. A firm insistence on the proper performance of duties in the line, reinforced by whatever sanction ingenuity can devise, is always salutary, both to the individual and to others. Now, these kind of statements undoubtedly seem harsh. It's important to keep in mind that the pressure that was on psychiatrists, military psychiatrists, to return men to the fighting line, that was what their job was, and to deal also with vast numbers of casualties that were coming through. Psychiatrists like Hunter as well were army officers as well. They had a duty to the war effort. And this, I think, explains really the value or the perceived value of suppressing a man's mental distress rather than actually addressing the causes and his therapeutic needs, perhaps. Now, the final form of treatment I'll mention is that was carried out at Hollymore Hospital at Northfield in Birmingham. It's generally known as Northfield. This is Northfield. This photograph dates from the First World War. It's quite an old one. And it's the treatment carried out here at Northfield that is often associated with perhaps some of the greatest successes of psychiatry, military psychiatry, in the Second World War. Northfield had been transferred to the use of by the military in 1942 for psychiatric patients. It indulged in various carried out various physical forms of treatment. This included narcosis, in other words, the use of drugs as both a sedative and also a relaxing agent. And also ECT was used. This was the use of electricity. But there were psychological measures too, and it's these that become well known and with which Northfield becomes associated, or famously associated. And psychiatrists there were faced with hundreds of patients and the job of dealing with them. And it was decided to gather patients together for ease of use, ease of treatment, in groups. Now, group psychotherapy was not a new idea, but its application to British military casualties was a fresh approach. So the wards were structured as democratic communities, and this was to encourage, so they elected representatives and they held discussions about how they should work and operate. And this was to encourage patients to offer each other a support, build relationships and regain a sense of community and duty to each other. Group discussions were held, again, with the same sort of effect, to examine and understand the process and also discuss the problems that they had. In short, the whole community really was both the patient and the means of treatment. And the main goal was to educate the whole community in the problems that men had and create a therapeutic atmosphere where individuals were encouraged to believe they were part of a soothing and social community. Now, two key individuals were involved in this, Wilfred Bion, formerly of the Tavistock Clinic, and also played a very important role in setting up the War Office selection boards, and also John Rickman. But the work of these two, Bion and Rickman, has tended to monopolise writing about Northfield, but there were other psychiatrists working there, and these other psychiatrists also introduced new measures, therapeutic measures, which did have some impact. So, for example, Harold Bridger took up a senior position there towards the end of 1944, and he introduced such things as organised a swimming pool, a hospital club, also a system of mentoring so that new patients would come under the helpful guise and friendship and guidance of an old hand, a patient who'd been there some time. He also opened a hut for art therapy. Things like a theatre was developed, sculpture. Now, these sorts of innovation, as some of you may know, have become swept up after the war and did become a feature, many of them are features of more NHS-provided psychotherapy. However, its records in Northfield are few and far between, and it's not really possible to take the degree of success that these had. It seems unlikely, in fact, that these kind of therapeutic processes, however adaptable and suitable they were for a peacetime world, did not achieve a great deal when the ultimate aim was to get men back into the fighting line. So I'll close now. What I've tried to do really in the last 50 minutes or so is to give you an idea of the variety of work in which psychiatrists were involved. Now, there were certainly forms of important innovation, I think. Psychotherapy is certainly one of them. And there was the use of drugs, which hadn't been used before in a conflict. So the First World War, drugs had been used, but never to this extent. I've also tried to give you an idea of the level of success, and it's my opinion that it was very limited, despite these forms of innovation. What the war did, I think, also was to re-educate people, psychiatrists and the military in general, about what had happened in the First World War and some of the conditions that were confronted then and some of the techniques of treatment that were adopted. Also, really, just the approach to psychiatric casualties, that some men were more vulnerable than others, that all men had a breaking point, and also there's the concept of forward psychiatry, which was found to be useful and did have some effect, on getting men back into the fighting line. Also, too, that these less benevolent methods, those that were adopted by men like Hunter, by Palmer to a degree, by focusing on a man's duty and his responsibility to his friends, trying to urge him and explain to him and reason with him to get him back to a fighting status and capable of fighting, as opposed to dealing with his psychiatric problems. That as well was appreciated as an effective way, to some extent, of actually getting man back into the front. But as I say, I don't think there were any great strides, no great leaps really forward in the treatment of psychiatric casualties. And I think when you look at the work of psychiatrists, military psychiatrists too, it's also important to recognise that they were confronted with a vast number of casualties, certainly in the form of numbers. And also it was impractical really for many psychiatrists, at least that's how they felt, to actually use the more drawn out psychotherapeutic treatments that you might find today and that were certainly employed in a more civilian environment. Above all, I think it needs to be kept in mind that there was an emphasis, very much an emphasis, a military emphasis, on returning men to the fighting line. So this wasn't focused really as such on the well-being of the individual's mind, but really it's just to fashion him, refashion him back into a weapon. And what this also, I think, and I'll finish with this, is that what the war does show really is the intractable conflict between psychiatrists and the army. So the everyday role of psychiatrists, of course, is to treat and to work on an individual's health. But the army here is very much focused on action, very much focused on the individual, has its own needs, and in the needs in wartime, and to actually to win the war against the enemy. And it's only later, really, in the 20th century, that adequate empathy can really be detected, I think, in the treatment of psychiatric casualties. Thank you.